I'd like to be remembered for being the first face on Channel 4. That's what I'm really most proud of.
Now, friends and colleagues, remember Mr. Countdown in a tribute to Richard Whiteley here on 4.
Let me just say, Richard would like people to remember him, however they remember him. He loved to be loved, and he revelled in television and being a part of it and being known in the nicest possible way. He felt he was one of the luckiest men on earth.
Whether fancied by ferrets...
Ow, ow, ow!
...probing prime ministers...
I'm sort of old enough almost to be your mother.
I wish you were.
...or just being where it mattered.
Hello from the cliff top in Scarborough.
Richard Whiteley was one of the most popular presenters in the history of British television. But there was one role more than any other that made him famous.
Well, hello. Hello, countdowners everywhere.
He was the man in the middle.
Big up yourself, keep it real.
The host with the most.
Apparently, that's real cool speak.
The mayor in the chair.
Anyway, I'm speaking on behalf of our champion.
For 23 years, Richard Whiteley presided over Britain's favourite parlour game, like a proud Yorkshire squire surveying his beloved land.
I'm thrilled and proud that today is the 3000th edition of Countdown.
Until his death at the age of 61, Richard had been at the helm of nearly 4,000 shows. That's 3 months end-to-end of wise words, sophisticated sums and countless conundrums. It was a marriage made in TV heaven. No wonder he became known as Mr. Countdown.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be able to say to you, welcome to Channel 4.
In November 1982, Channel 4 was born, and always one for being in the right place at the right time, Richard Whiteley was there to bring it kicking and screaming into the big wide world.
Richard was proud to be the first face on Channel 4. It meant an awful lot to him. And he loved that. He often quoted his line that he said on the first programme, as the countdown to a new channel ends...
A brand new countdown begins. This countdown is a quiz game that all of you can play at home. And if you're good with figures, or you figure you're good with letters, well, we think this could be the game for you, because it's...
Well, the first time I met him, because he was a, you know, big star on television in the Yorkshire area, which is where I just moved to. So I was... quite in awe of him.
Countdown, in fact, is about numbers as well as letters, and we figure we've got a pretty good figure ruling that part of the game. Meet our vital statistician, Carol Vorderman. She's a Cambridge graduate and she works in computers.
But he was ever so nice. He was very friendly, and he really wanted us to do well.
Our total, 833.
How does she do it?
In the early years on Countdown, I suppose I was doing a job and I was a young woman, and we became closer and closer and closer as the years went on.
The relationship between Richard and Carol is totally unique. I've never seen one like it anywhere. It's a real adoration. Richard worshipped Carol.
They were always delighted to see each other across the studio. And you can't fake that. You can't fake that real affection.
Well, I always felt that Richard was the best kind of flirt, you know.
Happy birthday!
But all the flirtation, but there was no follow-through. So, you know, he was a really safe date.
People will talk.
For over two decades, Richard and Carol entertained the nation from the Countdown studios in Leeds. As well as the loyal fans at home, more than 250,000 people joined in the fun as members of the studio audience.
Everyone who came into the audience, they all love Countdown, so we were all part and parcel of the same team in the studio. And more often than not, I'd beat him to the studio. And so I'd be chatting to the audience.
Please, God, don't let Richard tell any jokes today.
And then he'd come in. Oh, and they used to go mental for him. You know, they absolutely loved him.
Oh, hang on.
welly.
Is that what I call welly? Well, you didn't do well enough.
Started already.
He had these great routines with the studio audience, always try and involve them when he could, because he just made everyone feel that, you know, that he really was with them. And I think that's quite special. There are a lot of game shows where you don't get that rapport and you don't get that sense that someone's with you. And I think Richard did that beautifully.
We don't know many of the hymns. You have very sort of long hymns, I'm afraid.
And he wasn't just the audience's best friend.
Please welcome, alongside his striking partner, Susie Dent, the man of the match himself, Rick Wakeman.
Richard also had the knack of putting the guests in Dictionary Corner at ease.
I remember the first time I met Richard really, really well, because I'd been, through my agent, I'd been trying to get on the programme. Just like everybody else was trying to get on Countdown. Everybody wanted to get on Countdown.
It's a pleasure to welcome back Philip Franks, Tim Rice, Richard Stilgo, Henry Blofeld, with a song in her heart, Leslie Garrett, CBE.
He would just make you feel it was a walk in the park. He'd just make you feel you were only going to have good fun and that you had nothing to worry about at all.
Thank you, Richard, for that underwhelming introduction.
He seemed to be very enthusiastic about what everyone said. Sometimes one came up with really lame things, but he'd always get you out of a hole somehow.
Welcome, Blowers.
My dear old thing, it's very nice of you to have me back.
I felt I was at home, and this, I think, was his genius of making people feel at ease.
Thanks, Richard. I was going to be so nice about your jacket as well. Oh, he loved people who would spar with him a bit.
I've just found out that Richard Stilgo is an anagram of I dig Claire Short.
It was very easy, and he never missed anything. If you picked up on something, he would then keep it going all the way through the programme.
Today's guest in the Dictionary Dell, actually, she's got Polish forebears.
So Richard loved all the visitors to Dictionary Dell, but he had special reason to remember one particular guest, his partner, actress and presenter Catherine Apanovich.
What does a duck do?
A duck? Well, I went to a duck do once.
And what happened?
No, you meant to say, what's a duck do?
Oh, what's a duck do?
Quack, quack, quack.
Richard never forgot his celebrity friends in the corner. Thank you very much. It's just a shame he had such a struggle with the contestants.
Well done, Chris, and bad luck to you.
Thank you.
Stephen, don't go home empty-handed, nice goodie bag full of stuff. So thanks very much indeed, and farewell to Stephen Gatenby.
Stephen Draper.
Stephen Draper.
Richard, I could never remember people's names. Ever. Contestants, off, get it, you know.
377 Alec?
Oh.
But people over the years got used to it. I think a lot of contestants sort of came on hoping that you'd get their name right.
And it wasn't just the contestants.
I was going to call you
Carol. Carol Vorderman.
She said it. Carol Vorderman.
He was never quite on top of things, and it didn't matter at all. It was one of the things that gave the programme its appeal.
OK, Stanley, back to the board as you go. They'll be dancing in the streets of Melrose. No, not Melrose. Where do you live?
Sutton Coldfield.
Yes, Sutton Coldfield.
As the host of Countdown, Richard Whiteley was the man with the plan.
Well, lots of you won't have a clue what I'm talking about, so no.
The mayor in the chair.
313.
We have nine away. Oh, sorry, 3-1. I'll do that again.
The consummate professional.
That's how they can't use it, you see.
Well, that's what he would have liked us to have thought, anyway.
Of this series, we shall be back again in January of 1966. So may we.
96, Richard.
Bumbling he might have been, but no one could argue with the fact that Countdown's genial host was one of TV's most colourful personalities, and that was just his wardrobe.
I loved Richard's jackets, and I think it was only in the last few years that he really believed that I did love them, because every time I said I liked them, he thought I was taking the mickey, which I genuinely wasn't. Well, they were so much part of him, weren't they? And they're not nearly as garish as some people said.
Some of his jackets were a little loud. I think Richard delighted in wearing them.
Richard was like a marigold in a herbaceous border. He stood out.
He loved the ties. How many ties did he have? 500 and odd. He loved the ties and those very square jackets, which he got from one shop, I think, in Lincoln, I think he told me.
Who makes your jackets, by the way?
They are made by
skilled craftsmen who toil away.
But not jacket makers. Skilled craftsmen they might be.
It would have been terrible if he'd been styled. And thank heavens the Countdown team were far too bright to try to style him. He was just right.
Yes, Richard Whiteley was a man of many suits and ties, though most of them an acquired taste. But he was also a man of words, and just like his taste in clothes, he had the strangest of personal favourites.
There were certain words that would come up that were always, somehow they always kind of prompted this fresh reaction in Richard.
Leotards.
And you'd think that leotard coming up for the millionth time, and honestly must be a millionth time.
Leotards.
He would just be slightly jaded about it, but no. He would leap on it and his hands would kind of come up.
Love leotards.
Tangelo kept on coming up.
Tangelo. Brilliant. Well done. Our old friend the Tangelo. Excellent.
And Richard would ask me every single time, Susie, what is a Tangelo?
Apparently, a Tangelo is a cross between an orange and a tangerine.
A cross between a tangerine and an orange.
It's a cross between a tangerine and a grapefruit. That's a Tangelo.
I think we need no further description.
Let's have a little nodule
on Yes. Put it down. I think as the years went on, he got better, or should that be worse? And we loved him for that. And did encourage him quite a bit in it.
If someone gets an 18-point lead, it's a bit of a bugger, isn't it?
It is rather.
I don't know why I said that.
Scotland.
Carol would often say to him, look, you're on another planet. And, well, I think he was half the time, really.
We decided to go in to make further inquiries. And my husband... It's not that funny, really.
I can imagine him at school telling exactly the same jokes.
We decided to go in and make further inquiries. My husband confronted the assistant. We decided to go and make further inquiries. And my husband confronted the assistant with the words, excuse me, how Dutch is that moggy in the window?
He's probably up in heaven telling God one now. He's probably still at the gate having a chat.
Did you get it?
Despite the terrible jokes and painful puns, Richard became one of the most loved faces on British television.
Richard Whiteley is undoubtedly a national treasure. You know, there aren't many that you think of, oh, gosh, he's a national treasure. You might think of, I don't know, Thora Hird or Harry Secombe or... You know, you have to really be in the hearts of the general public to be given that title.
Hello, by the way. We've made it to the second week of the new... century, I suppose, unscathed by anything, haven't we? Carol,
we're
still here.
It's Friday, isn't it?
No disasters. No, it's Monday today.
No, it's Friday, Richard.
It's not. It's Monday today. Oh, it's Friday today.
Richard, whose virtues are sweetness and kindness and ineptitude, really, but good nature and good humour, we could do a lot worse than to celebrate a national treasure like him.
Anyway, I heard Rita's here. Where's Rita?
Yeah,
hello, Rita.
Yeah.
How are you? Nice to see you. I heard you were here.
He never really quite understood why everybody wanted to talk to him, everybody loved him. I still think he thought of himself very much as an ordinary person who did a little bit on the telly and, you know. He had no idea, really, what an institution he was. Not a clue.
There's Dick the Lionheart and Dick the Third, Dick Van Dyke and Dickie Bird. There's Dick Turpin with his horse, Black Bess. Dick Barton, special agent, no less. There's Moby Dick, the great white whale. Dick Francis, who can tell a tale. But of all the Dicks I can recall, Mr. Whiteley is the greatest Dick of all.
The one thing I will always stand by with Richard is that I don't think the population realised what an amazing intellect he was. He was incredibly intellectual. And the bumbling, I think, was a very pleasant aspect about him, but he wasn't a bumbling fool by any means at all.
I'm still one away, but...
Why don't I have a go? What?
Oh, no. Have you done it?
Well, I don't know. Might have done. 7 minus 6 is 1.
It is.
He was always very proud of me being able to do the numbers game, because he knew how much it meant to me, to be honest, because I still get annoyed when I don't get it in the time. I get really angry with myself. But occasionally I wouldn't get it, and he did. Now, it didn't happen very often, but when it did happen, well, I mean, you know, he was absolutely cock of the north. He thought it was fantastic. He thought I was doing me out of a job as well.
Do you know what?
Add the night.
His very laid-back, self-deprecating manner concealed high intelligence. Didn't always conceal it. Sometimes his intelligence came bubbling through to the surface for all to see, but he was a very clever man.
Right out of the blue, he'd come out with some perfect Shakespearean quote that included this word that we'd come up with in Dictionary Corner, or he'd just recite this bit of poetry that he remembered.
I can't imagine a national treasure being dim, but I can certainly imagine them being cuddly and lovable.
5 times 100 is 500.
It is.
10 minus 3 is 7.
Ah, do you know, I think you can get it right, yep.
7 times 7 is 49.
Is 49.
Add them on.
That is brilliant. That really is very good.
Richard became such a national treasure that it was rumoured he even had followers among the highest echelons of British society.
Just a bit of fun, just a bit of fun, right?
Richard loved the fact that the Queen watched Countdown. I think he pictured her wearing her crown and possibly carpet slippers, viewing the programme, cup of tea in hand, corgis at her feet, and was quite disconcerted when the time of transmission was changed because he knew that earlier in the afternoon the Queen wouldn't be able to watch the programme because that's the time when the Queen takes the corgis for a walk. So he felt a bit sorry about that. But I think it did give him something to chat to her about when he went to collect his OBE.
And it was so, so important to him. And if you watch the footage of him actually getting it with the Queen, I just know he was saying, so do you really watch it?
I said, yes, and you've got 2 vowels and a consonant, and I've only got, because I've got an MBE, I said, 1 vowel and 2 consonants. Oh, and he laughed and laughed and laughed. He said, I'll nick that line. And the day he went to get his OBE, and Kathy went with him, and James, his son. And then afterwards, he had lunch for, it was about 20 of us at the Ritz. Oh, and he was, you know, the entertainer was there. And he was just so proud of it. And it was the most, most wonderful day.
Here's a nice one. Look at this one. Be one's Valentine. My dear Mr. Whiteley, OBE, you are and will remain my one true King Dick.
If ever an entertainer deserved to be honoured by his country, it was Richard Whiteley, a true man of the people, who will always be remembered fondly.
I will always love you.
He should be there going into his dressing room. Every time we're in studio, he should be sitting in that chair. Yeah, I will miss him a lot.
I've just got great memories. Proud to have been his friend.
And I really miss him. Already.
I don't think I can really say how much we're going to miss him. It's very hard being in the studio. I'm all right facing this way because I don't have to look that way, which is the way I normally face. But, I don't know. Can't really say how much words... nine-letter words have failed me in this particular instance. He was Countdown, you know. Still is Countdown.
If you'd like to pay your personal respects, please sign our special condolence book at channel4.com/countdown.